I'm very pleased to have the opportunity today to chair what I think will be a very, very interesting panel on a topic which is of great interest and importance to most of us, namely our pensions, and indeed the pensions of future generations. And hence the title of the seminar, IORPs 2, Will My Children Have a Pension? Because everybody always thinks that that's a given, but if we see demographic changes taking place, if we see turbulence in the finance world, then maybe the certainty that we thought we had isn't quite as strong as that. So there are a couple of things that I would want to raise today. I want this to be a fairly open debate, but the reason that I wanted to have this seminar is that in recent years in Parliament, we've had, first we had a debate on the Green Paper on pensions. Now we're debating proposals on IORP, and I'm very pleased that we have the rapporteur, Brian Hayes, with us today. And throughout the debate, I get the feeling that we are debating the past, and that there are very strong taboos about looking at pensions from a new angle. And I remember when we were debating the Green Paper that basically the only thing that everybody kept repeating is, as long as it's not a Solvency II. That was about all. You know, everybody agreed on that, and there was absolutely no vision on how we're going to secure retirement provisions for future generations. I mean, I come from a country, the Netherlands, where we have a long tradition in pension funds, and we always thought that we had the best system in the world, and maybe we do, but we also considered that it was completely immune to outside problems, and I think that the financial crisis has shown us that we are not immune, and we still have a pretty good system, but I do think that we have reasons for looking at it more closely and see if it's really future-proof. I know that in many member states, including my own, there is a kind of allergic reaction if in the European Parliament we're discussing pensions, because they say, ah, that's a purely national competence. And of course, the way that pension systems are organized is indeed a purely national competence. At the same time, at least the countries that are in the Eurozone have an obligation under the Stability and Growth Pact to ensure that their pension systems are sustainable and future-proof and not a systemic risk to the Eurozone. So at least from that perspective, we have every reason to be discussing pension systems at a European level. Another reason is that I note that in my country, and I imagine it's much the same in countries with a similar system, is that the whole pensions debate is dominated by people from a certain generation who have a certain interest in keeping things the way they are. But that is not necessarily the same interest as that of younger generations. And the younger generations are simply not the people taking decisions. It's that simple. They're not represented or not adequately anyway, and that makes the whole debate very one-sided. I noted that in the Netherlands, and it was in the newspapers again this morning, on the one hand, people say, you know, Europe has no right to even look at our system because it's perfect, nobody should touch it. At the same time, I get the feeling, with very limited knowledge of bookkeeping, that what we are seeing here is that basically they're juggling the figures at the expense of future generations. The Dutch National Bank just issued a report saying that 155 pension funds that didn't look so solid, they took a closer look and said, oh, but it's all okay because in future years they will make a profit anywhere between 5% and 7%. That seems fairly optimistic. Now, I'm an optimist, otherwise I wouldn't be in politics, but you also have to be realistic. And this, to me, sounds like taking an irresponsible gamble with the pensions of future generations. And then a final element is labor market patterns are changing. you know, the old pattern where you would start working for a boss at the age of 25 and you'd work for 40 years and then you'd get your pension. I mean, that doesn't exist anymore. People may work as an employee for a couple of years, then they may work as a self-employed for a couple of years, then they work for another organization, then they may take a year off. So there isn't, you know, it's not as if people stay put in one place anymore. And I think that our pension systems should reflect that new reality. I know that the Dutch government is actually, for the first time, developing new ideas on how to answer that new situation. And I think here, the European internal market is going to play a key role, because when we're talking about more individual products and maybe people managing their own individual pension provisions, but within the context of a collective fund or something like that, that means that there will be providers of financial services in the internal market who are going to play a key role. So that's a bit to set the scene and to give you an overview of the kind of topics that I think we should be addressing today. I'm going to introduce the panel to you, and I would actually like to make a small change in the order on the agenda, if that's okay with you. I haven't consulted with you, but I would actually like to start with our rapporteur, Brian Hayes, to my right. To his right, Ilya Boulars, who's risk manager and PhD candidate at the University of Chicago. So we're particularly pleased to have you here. And I know that Ilya in the Netherlands has been extremely outspoken in the whole debate. Then to my left, Professor Hans van Meerten from the Utrecht University School of Law, who's also a familiar face because he was just before the holiday break in a hearing dedicated to the same topic organized by the Econ Committee. And finally, to his left, Mrs. Manuela Zweimüller, who is the head of Department of Regulations of IOPA. And I'm also extremely pleased to have you here, not only because IOPA is, of course, responsible for this kind of issues, but I also got the feeling that IOPA has fairly, let's say, has very visionary ideas about the future and is not held back by the kind of taboos that I feel is sometimes dominating the debate in this house. So this is about all I will say for now. I'm going to give the floor to each of the speakers for a short introduction of about 10 minutes, after which I'm going to open the floor for questions and debate, and all of you can then intervene, so you can already prepare your questions and remarks. So first I'm going to invite the rapporteur. You have the floor.
Thank you very much indeed, Sophie, and congratulations to you and ALDE for bringing us together on the same platform and to debate these issues openly. I very much agree with you. We need a big, broad debate across the European Union on the issue of pension cover and its many facets, because it's not simple. It is divided, as many people in this room know, into how much state pension people are entitled to at one level, Pillar 1. Pillar 2, then, on the whole question then of occupational pensions, and of course the huge shift that has occurred in recent years from defined benefit to defined contribution schemes, which are becoming more common. And then thirdly, the whole question of private pension cover, which has become a much more recent feature, I suppose, through ABCs and the like, whereby people are putting money aside. One of the reasons I suspect, to answer your question, which I think is a provocative but a very honest question about the taboos issue, one of the reasons people are so sensitive about this is that we are talking about other people's money. We're talking in the main about people who have put their money to one side. They effectively have deferred part of their income as a means of protecting themselves and their families into the future. So in any attempt that is made to provide some harmonization or some common rules, we've got to be mindful of that. We are talking about other people's money, not our money, other people's money. It's not state money, it's effectively money that people have put aside, 5%, 6%, whatever, of their monthly pay as a means of ensuring that they can meet their future liabilities. And equally, And I think that's important to say. Equally, it's important to say that many people make their decisions in terms of employment based on the kind of pension cover that occupational pensions might deliver. So in any area where we are looking at a common approach in Europe, we've got to be sensitive and mindful of that, notwithstanding the fact there's a lot of Dutch people and Irish people on the panel here. It does remind me of this is on the occupational side, there's a huge interest in this area of a small number of countries, because effectively the great majority of IORPs across the European Union are dominated in a number of countries: Ireland, Britain, Germany, the Netherlands. Of course, in Eastern Europe and the Mediterranean countries, we don't see that. And do we need to get to a permanent pension provision for all European citizens into the future? Yes, is my view. But I think we've got to make incremental steps in getting there, and we've got to do it with confidence. In a circumstance where so much crisis has been the underlying economic issues that we have faced over the course of the last number, the last 8-9 years, we've got to make sure that any change we make is proportionate and actually does not increase the costs on those people who are currently saving, increase the costs on the schemes, or create more uncertainty and doubt, whereby more and more people, our employers, do not actually add into that scheme or actually contribute to that scheme. So I think that's basically my mindset going into this file when I got it. I'm very conscious of what we can achieve, but I think we need to be also sensitive to those concerns that are there. Where is the state of the play on my report? As you might know, I published my report in the last week of July, just in time so that you could all take it on your holidays and to go to the beaches with it, I suspect. All 267 amendments of the original proposal that was made by the Commission. As Sophie said, we had a very good hearing at Econ before the summer period, which I think managed to crystallise a number of the issues. And I very much look forward to working. I'll be making a formal presentation to Econ, I think, on the 14th of this month. And I look forward to working with Sophie and other shadow rapporteurs to make sure that we have a good outcome. It seems to me that the Commission proposal, which came in 2004, and there was a question mark that was raised at the time in terms of, do we need IORPs too? And I believe we do, to answer Sophie's question about the future. I think from a consolidation perspective, in terms of the existing legislation that is, what is it, nearly 10 years old, we need to. And secondly, in responding to those employment patterns and trends that are there, labour market trends, about 3.5% to 4% of the European labour market moves to work now. That's going to dramatically change. It has to change into the future. And we've got to make sure that our pension system and the structures we have in place across Europe are fit for purpose and robust, are systems that actually can allow European-wide business to perform the kind of pension cover for its workers, even if those workers are working in Germany for 4 years, the Netherlands for 5 years, and Ireland for 10 years. We've got to adapt. And I think it's interesting, when we went through a lot of the presentations for the committee and a lot of the hearings, that there are real genuine barriers that are there against having a genuine single market when it comes to having certainly cross-border IORPs from one country to the next. So I'm very minded by that. Let's be very frank. The fact that IORPs won produced the concept of a cross-border IORP, we have seen, 87 or 84 over the course of the last decade? I mean, it's appallingly small. And we've got to ask ourselves, in the course of our dialogue on the file before us, why is that? What are the barriers that prevent companies, large companies especially, European successful businesses, in having cross-border IORPs? Why is it the case that the regulatory system from one country to the next effectively is providing barriers to that? And it seems to me that if we are to have a cross-border IORP situation across the European Union, encourage it, that's good for business, it's good for employees, it's good for European-wide multinationals, it's good for the regulatory environment, that we have much more interconnectedness. And the way in which you do that, in my view, is through the cross-border IORPs, which I am particularly strong about. So if I can just say that, I mean, yes, of course, we need to be mindful of the regulatory system that applies state by state. We cannot have one size fits all. We all know that. Different countries are coming from different perspectives, different history, different demographics, different deficit positions, of course. But nonetheless, we need to have some common harmonised goals and principles that we can all agree to, which we can make some progress on. I do believe there's a need for this legislation, even though I know it went through the better regulation perspective that came from this commission. I do very much agree that there is a need for it. I think also we need to make sure that the European labour market is not hampered by the fact that we have so few cross-border IORPs. That's something that we need to do. And we also need to make savings by way of the internal market. And I think we can achieve those things with a proposal that I have put forward. But I mean, I want to make it very clear that my proposal is for discussion. And if there are better ideas on the table from my colleagues, especially across the political groups in ECON, I want to hear those. And I've had a very open mind about how we can achieve that. But my report is the first, if you like, stab at what we're trying to achieve. Just very briefly, I don't need to tell people in this room, and maybe I do, that if one looks at the old age dependency ratio, I mean, it is going to double by 2060. In 2008, for every one pensioner, we had four workers. By 2060, as I understand it, we will have two workers for every one pension. So this is a time bomb that is coming down the tracks quickly, not least on the minimum requirement for state provision, but also for younger people as to how they will be able to afford a proper funded pension scheme into the future. And it's something that we need to address. Very briefly, to go through some of the main themes in my report on cross-border activity. This is the main focus, really, of what I have to say. For the first time, I have actually put a definition of what a cross-border IORP is. We have not had that so far. No one can come to agreement. I think that's very important. I also think the fact that we have defined what a home member state is and what a host member state is important. We have not had that thus far. What I've also proposed within the directives is the ability for transfers within member states and also transfers from one IORP to the next. And I think setting the same kind of standardised approach is the right way. If one looks at the real barrier that people spoke to me about in the course of cross-border IORPs was, number one, if you want to establish it, you need the regulatory authority of one country to accept it, but equally the regulatory authority, the home and host country, of another country to accept it. Now, in my view, we should have one authorization, because if you have two authorizations, it's providing a veto to one regulatory authority over the next. I don't think that makes sense. Now, I know the Council disagree with that view. I agree with the Commission view that we should have actually one. I think that actually makes more sense if we're trying to encourage more cross-border IORPs into the future and create those kind of savings that we want to see. On funding provisions, the other big barrier on cross-border was it must be funded at all times. In my view, that is creating an unfair barrier as well. What I have said in my report is, in terms of the establishment of cross-border IORPs, that it should be funded at the moment of the establishment of the operation. And after that, obviously, it'll be a matter for the regulator to take a view, and no one wants to be so prescriptive as to make it impossible for the regulator to come to that view. But that's something that I've said that I think it should be important. And equally, that principle should apply for the merging of occupational pension schemes within member states. It should be the case that you should be fully funded at the time of the establishment of the scheme. I don't think that that's unfair. If we have one set of European standards across the European Union here, we shouldn't have a lower standard in member states, and I'm going to argue for that in the course of my work. On information requirements, and I did follow, I mean, we had two committees who worked hard on this issue before my own report came out. I was very mindful of trying to not be so prescriptive in terms of information requirements as to make it very difficult, particularly on the pension benefit statement. So I have removed quite a number of those articles to create what I call guiding principles, rather than such a prescriptive outcome that would make it impossible for one country or the next. I've also proposed in my report the establishment of a high-level working group on coordination, looking at the whole question of Pillar 2 and Pillar 3, trying to shine a light, really, on best practice. I think there are many member states, older member states, if you like, which have had a tradition of occupational pension cover. And I think many newer member states might like to learn from that and see the importance of that and exactly what's the kind of regulatory requirements that are needed member state to member state. We've also put in, particularly to the recital section, the importance of trying to tally pension cover and pension pots and the significance that they are with the longer term financing needs of Europe to make sure that nothing we say in this is in some way counter to what we're trying to achieve with the new FC investment package, and I think that's important. I've also, for the first time, really nailed my colours to the mask on the whole question of social partners. I mean, IORPs are different. They are different because it is effectively an employer and an employee coming to an agreement as to what they want at the end of their employment as a result of a pension cover. And I do think we need to, it's not just about finance, it's also about social policy. And having spoken to many people within the industry and on the verges of industry, I think it's important that we state that in the report, that there is a really strong social reason. This is something that we need to celebrate in Europe, that we have had the prevalence of occupational pensions for a large number of years. And it's something that I think we should take a great comfort in. And then finally, on the question of subsidiarity and delegated acts, the directive contains a large number of delegated acts in the area of risk assessment, remuneration policy, and the pension benefit statement. Since I believe that pension policy is primarily that for the member states, notwithstanding the need to have a general guiding principle across Europe, I've decided to take out some of those unnecessary elements of the report to have greater clarity in the legislation about what exactly is in the mind of the European Parliament as it attempts to create this new standard for the 28 member states of the European Union. So I hope we can achieve, they're my thoughts on the issue, but I am open for persuasion in the course of our dialogue. And I think, in order to produce a good package, and more importantly, a package that's going to withstand the pressures of the economic difficulties one way or the other over the next decade or so, we need to get that package right. And some of the work is around consolidation of the package of nearly 10 years standing now. Others are around trying to make sure that we get more cross-border IORPs. I think that is the kind of incremental approach which will ensure certainty for all of the players involved here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that extensive overview. And I think I can already preempt some of the debate by saying that I very largely agree with you. There's just one remark I want to make before I hand over to Ilya. That's you started out by saying, why is it a sensitive issue and why are people ill at ease with European debate? You said, well, it's because we're talking about other people's money, but I think that's precisely the point. It's not as if Europe is touching the money of the nation states. We're actually talking about potentially protecting the money from younger generations against vested interests who are taking irresponsible risks or taking risks at the expense of future generations and their pension entitlements. So in the end, I don't think that having a European debate is threatening anybody's money. Quite the contrary, we're actually trying to get protection for younger generations in particular. But also, you mentioned the social partners. That's the only thing that I would like to have a debate about with you, because, for example, the trade unions, in my country at least, I think the average age of trade union members at the moment is 56 or something like that. I mean, how representative is that? And how can they decide pensions, not only of future generations, but for example, also people who are not employed by a company. So I think we need to widen that debate. But I just wanted to make absolutely clear that we're not actually talking about taking people's money away or putting their money at risk. It's quite the opposite. We're talking about protecting future generations. Okay, having said that, I'm going to hand over to Ilya.
Thank you, Sophie. I was doubting a little bit what I was going to do, but let me start by telling a little bit maybe my personal story, how I got involved in this topic, because I think it's kind of, well, at least in many, many rooms like this, I feel a little bit out of place, because I'm usually the youngest person talking about the topic. And So what happened? I studied economics and graduated around 2008, and at the time, of course, the financial crisis hit our markets. And I also, at the time, joined, well, for full disclosure, it's Sophie's party. I joined the youth organization of Sophie's party, and I ended up as a board member there. And at that time, in Holland, which has indeed a very big second pillar pension system, politicians, labor unions, employers were having fierce debates about what to do to these pension funds, because after the crisis hit, there were big shortfalls there, and so something had to be done. And since I was in the board of this political youth organization, I was following it closely, and I didn't know much about pensions yet at the time. But I did realize what political game was going on, because the Minister of Social Affairs really needed the retirement age of the state pension to go up. And labor unions were always very fiercely against that. But then now the labor unions were responsible for the second pillar pension. And they needed a solution to the shortfalls in these pension funds. And so what happened is that the Minister of Social Affairs traded like this retirement age for the first pillar against loosening prudential standards for the second pillar. So he allowed the second pillar funds, which are basically run by labor unions in Holland, to use higher discount rates. So they could just basically change the value of their liabilities in the books to make stuff look a little bit nicer, which was great for the labor unions because they, as you just mentioned, primarily serve the interest of their members, which are on average above 50. So when I saw that, I realized this is very bad for my generation, because now what is the English word for it? It's almost fraud, right? Like they're changing the books of these pension funds. So these, yeah. I always call it Greek accounting. They allowed Greek accounting to allow the pension funds to keep paying those benefits to the retired workers, but obviously at the expense of someone, and that someone was, well, my generation, but also I think workers, actually mainly workers around 40, who were still spending their time working and didn't realize that at some point they had to retire too, and that then at that time the pension funds would have lost a lot of money because the accounting standards were relaxed. So that's kind of when I got involved, because I was just shocked how actually, because this was actually a deal that was signed by the Dutch cabinet, and I just couldn't believe that they would get away with that. So that's when I kind of started organizing, like a protest against it. But it was kind of hard, of course, because I had to explain all these young people, like, this is important stuff. This is like about billions of euros, and this is going to cost you maybe, because I saw some calculations, like it was going to cost like 20-30% of their pension in the long run. So that's kind of how I got involved. And soon I realized that actually the whole pension industry actually was against young people. And that was also something that shocked me. Like, all the trustees of these funds, they are lobbying for the relaxation of these accounting standards. Why? Because for them, they have like a 5-year horizon, right? That's their term. And they don't like telling their members like, oh, we're actually in pretty bad shape. We send you all these nice letters all the time that we're doing great, and now suddenly we have bad news. No, they don't like to do that. And so they also try to fix their books, right? And the problem is they have a big budget. Like I was a youngster. I like volunteered for this political organization, and then I showed up in Parliament because I got invited to talk about it. Then I saw all these nice cars showing up, lobbyists, everyone. Like the public, the area for the public was filled by lobbyists, and I just thought, how are we gonna win this battle? Like how am I gonna? But well, so the good news is actually in Holland, at some point, because of the support of some professors of finance, Well, and I guess because of our own like efforts, actually this deal in the end ended up in some drawer, because at some point the Minister of Social Affairs realized what he was doing, and he kind of decided, okay, well, maybe just put it aside and not talk about it that much anymore. Because it's kind of a shame. I actually heard from his inner circle that he was kind of ashamed afterwards, because he didn't realize before that like how crucial these accounting standards are, and how changing some of these parameters, it seems like nothing, right? Like changing an interest rate by 1% or something, it seems futile, but in the context of pensions, because of the horizons are so long, we're talking about changing these parameters a little bit will mean like transfers of billions between generations. So when I realized that, actually I thought this is actually a fundamental problem that we have to fix. And that's when I started to talk with these youth organizations about we should actually reform the system and make it kind of robust to these valuation standards. We should come up with something so we don't have to lobby all the time to make sure that these valuation standards are maintained. And so that's when it was mentioned, I think you mentioned it in the introduction, at some point, so I organized a coalition of political youth organizations, and we kind of wrote a template for what the pension system should look like. And it seems, I'm actually very optimistic right now, it seems like slowly more and more people are kind of supporting the main idea in there. And the most important thing I would say is is that property rights for individuals should be very clear. Because what I described before was property rights weren't clear, because if at some point like some accounting standard was changed a little bit, that would mean a big transfer between different groups of people. And so what we need is a system that's not that vulnerable to changing those things, because it's so easy, right, for politicians or to make those changes, because nobody understands those complex accounting systems. So that's basically what I'm trying to push at the moment still, because we're still fighting about discount rates and accounting standards all the time, because the big pension funds keep lobbying, and they even I think tomorrow in Parliament you'll see Dutch pension funds showing up and trying to get higher discount rates for their liabilities. And that's a little bit now to make the step to IORP 2. That was a little bit like a disappointment for me, because I realized how important prudential regulation is. That I think, well, so I didn't read the whole thing, of course, but I think any reference to these prudential requirements, I think, has been removed now. And as a young individual, I think, well, that's a big shame, because I really, as a young person, I really need allies in this, right? I really need, like, it's not the pension fund boards that are gonna serve my interests. I really need like government, and whether it's a Dutch government or European at the European level, I don't really care. I just need allies in this, and I think at the end, so it's a shame that it's not there. And and actually, it's funny you mentioned that people kind of respond allergically, saying stuff like, "As long as it's not a Solvency II, I wish it was a Solvency II." I mean, it's because. I'm not sure if Mr. Hayes was aiming at that when you mentioned like we don't need something that makes it more expensive, because that's often what people say. When you make accounting standards tighter, it makes pensions more expensive, but it's not true. It just shows in your books more transparently what the actual cost is, and that's not making stuff more expensive. It's just because you see actually all over the world. When you're looking at pensions, actually all over the world this is a problem. Like whether you're here in Europe or in America, I study in the United States, and there you see state pension funds in trouble right now because for a long time they didn't recognize the true cost. And that was great for politicians over the past 30 years because they didn't have to raise taxes to pay for these benefits. And it was great for labor unions because at the negotiation table they could get very generous benefits. But at some point, you'll get into trouble. And that's in my state of Illinois, that's what's happening right now. And it's actually a big crisis. Like they have to cut education expenses. They have to cut expenses on police, on firemen, everything, just because the pension fund is now like basically bankrupt. I don't know. I'm on time, but I guess that's a kind of a little introduction on what I do and what I think is important.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was a very good illustration of some of the points we're trying to make here today, or at least I want to make. Picking up on two things, you used the term Greek accounting. I think that's funny because the whole of Europe, including the IMF, they're all coming down on the Greeks and say, you know, you can't do creative bookkeeping, yeah. Whereas that's exactly what is happening in many pension funds, yeah. And they're actually getting, you know, that's being protected by national governments, and they're basically saying, you know, Europe, butt out. We don't want mm-hmm. you to expose yeah. these practices. I'm being a bit blunt now. And the second thing is you talk about prudential standards, and there's the big elephant in the room, capital requirements. Yep. Mm-hmm. And let's not forget, I mean, I know that I'll probably, you said we need a solvency too for pension funds. If I say that, my political career is over. Yep. At the same
then
time.
Say it. Yeah. If you believe it, say it.
You'd like that, wouldn't you?
I'll say it.
No, but at the same time, when we had the debate here, I think it was our Green colleague who said, well, but you should apply the same rule if there's the same risk, because pension mm-hmm. funds are, as you rightfully said, and you made reference to EFSI, they're also investors. Therefore, they're also exposed to turbulence in financial markets, for example, and we have seen that, and they're trying to cover that up now by basically fiddling the accounts, as they did again these days. But that's not actually going to change the actual situation. So I don't think, I will not say that there should be a solvency too, but I also say that there should not be a taboo on raising these issues and pointing at the risks that there are. And then, you know, the solution may well be something different from solvency too, but we shouldn't declare it a taboo. Next speaker on the list, Professor Van Meerten, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I agree with some parts you all just said. Is that acceptable? Some parts. So I will deal with them, of course. Let me put a little bit background what I'm doing right now. A couple of years ago, I am an EU lawyer from origin. So I approach things from an EU law perspective. And later on, basically in 2006, 2007, I entered into the field of pensions. And for an EU lawyer, there are strange things happening in that field. But I will explain that to you later. From that thought, by the way, is the whole PPI. It's a Dutch IORP built. It's a cross-border. It has a cross-border ambition, at least. And it's a very European-minded vehicle, in a way, because all the legislation is basically, all around it, is basically EU legislation, mostly. And second of all, pension law. And so it's very important how you look at, I think, pensions. Are they nationally? Mostly, or are they European? Well, I think that they are European, or they should be European, because I think pensions are the heart, actually, of the internal market, which we are into right now, all of us, all 28 member states. And again, I think that pensions is a very good example of actually the one thing that pops to my mind is the core of the internal market, even more than all other things, I would say. So it cannot be the case, for example, that you work in member state A and that you have a different pension than in member state B. That's funny to me. Most people, by the way, are also complaining about that. So, but we'll get also into that later. But before I was active in the field of pensions, or before mostly simultaneously, I also did the Solvency II negotiations in Brussels for the Dutch government. And there I found out the whole Solvency II framework, the whole prudential framework which has been developed, is basically about consumer protection. So all the 16 years of negotiations, basically, I would say, it took, maybe even more, if you count the period in the pre-negotiations also. You know, the core of the matter always I kept in mind is, why are we developing this? Why are we doing this? And it's all about, again and again, it's about making the arrangement clearer. So I learned from that, basically, that if you don't arrange that for in the IORP 2 directive one way or the other, you take out the core of the thing that you are actually trying to achieve, which is consumer protection. And I agree a lot of things that you are doing in the report. I think there are a lot of good things in it. You mentioned them already, especially in the fully funding requirements. And I also agree with you that there should not be a veto on both sides of the supervisory authorities or the member states. But the core of the matter is, in fact, I still believe, and I agree with Ilya also, is that it's the prudential standards. Another question, of course, is, but what is an IORP? You know, but as long as you more or less have defined that and you apply the scope of the directive to the IORPs, then you should also arrange for prudential standards, because it cannot be, it's one or the other. I will also address what are IORPs a little bit later, but I'll try to make it short. What we see mostly in the Netherlands, by the way, is now that the frame, mostly with people on the social media, which are saying, yeah, Europe is by developing prudential standards is stealing our money. You know, that's what you hear all the time, and in all kinds of chemia, I would say. And I always say then, okay, but if, for example, Dutch pension funds define their property rights clearer, we would not have that issue in the first place. You know, so it's about property rights. And that's exactly what the Dutch government is trying to achieve right now. And I think the Dutch government is also, the last 2-3 years, in the forefront, actually, of developing a new pension system, because they see, well, we're not heading the right way. And property rights, defining them clearer, is a key to them. So in the new pension contract, you know, it should be one of the core elements, at least, of that new system should be individual property rights. And they also have, they are saying, I think they are even saying that out loud, is that we should move to DC, to DC system. I wrote a few articles on that. We refer to it as CIDC, so Collective Individual Defined Contribution, so where you keep the asset management collective, but still, you know, you have individual property rights and you have a DC scheme, basically, in the end. That's much clearer for the participant. That's also much clearer for cross-border purposes, because yeah, it doesn't really matter anymore in which member state you live, because your individual rights remain the same, I would say. Yeah. Of course, very important in that is that you develop some sort of list of requirements, how to fulfill the information on the DC schemes. You know, that's very crucial also. Not only, first of all, of course, for protecting the citizens, but also making clearer the promise you might or not do to the participant, to make that much clearer. If we look at the IORP 2 directive, the way it is now, let's say the council compromise is, in my view, a huge step back, because it should make it easier, I would say, to be cross-border and not harder. And that's exactly what's happening. And we can, of course, say, yeah, but why do we need it? We only have 78 IORPs or whatsoever. But it's more or less catch-22 situation, you know, because we have so little IORPs, because it's so difficult, even on the IOR1 directive, to be cross-border liaisons, you know. So I would say let's break it open, you know, more than let's tighten the scope. So that's the explanation I have for that. So it's the other way around, basically, almost. Huh? For example, if we look for one of the elements in the IORP2 directive, in your report, Mr. Hayes, is a step in the right direction. I agree with that, but there are some things, and especially I already mentioned them, the solvency requirements. You know, you even go that far by saying IOPA has no role in that respect. IOPA should not develop prudential standards. Well, first of all, I wonder whether that's technically at all possible, because then you need to alter the IOPA regulation itself, or even diminish IOPA at, you know, completely, just throw it away, you know, then it cannot do anything anymore. But I wonder whether that's the right direction. And for two reasons. First of all, I think it's better to arrange for the solvency requirements in the directive, because the member states are there. You know, they can also discuss the contents of the prudential standards, and that's why I was amazed a little bit about the Dutch position, for example, which prevented solvency requirements. They were a very big player in this respect. But in the Netherlands, we have an even tighter regime. It's called the FTK, you know, which is even harder for pension funds in the Netherlands. But they try to block, you know, the development of prudential regulation on the European level. And it was more or less surprising, because to me at least, because I would say, well, if you try to develop that standard on a European level, you might have more chances. And now you see IOPA developing prudential standards, which you're not even part of. So I think it's a foolish thing to do for several reasons. So I would say, Mr. Hayes, maybe look at it again and try to come up with some kind of solution where there should be a prudential regulation for the IORPs in the directive. I think that's a very important message here. If we look at, two more minutes, okay? If we look at the Dutch developments, and especially it's connected to a European development, it's called ReSaver. That's initiative of the European Commission. It's a pan-European pension fund, actually, for mobile scientists. So they try, Dutch universities also want to be, I will get to that, want to be a part of that, but they can't because of the mandatory participation we have in the Netherlands. So it's difficult for them, you know, to transfer their money, basically, to ReSaver, because the mandatory participation hinders that, you know, it's very difficult. And of course, we can come up with all kinds of ways in which we try to loosen that requirement. Yeah, but that all, you know, adds up to the fact that I wonder how long the mandatory participation in the Netherlands is sustainable, and that's exactly the reason why the unions are blocking any progress in that field. So again, I would say it's not very, very, future-proof, you know, their attitude. But again, the Dutch developments, the ReSaver, the pan-European development, and the Dutch involvement in there is very important, and we should, of course, maintain that. But I see that, that the Dutch legislature is moving towards another direction compared to 2 years ago. It's much more aware of the problems we are facing, and I hope that other European member states will follow that that example.
Okay, thank you very much for that very rich contribution. And then I'm going to invite our final speaker of today's panel, Mrs. Zweimüller, you have the floor.
So So thank you so much, and first of all, thank you, Sophie van Velt, to have IORPA invited here for this debate. I think it's very, very important that you get a variety of views and that you also get the views of a technical body to the political, influence also the political debate. I think that is important. So thank you so much, and thanks also to my co-panelists of providing such a variety of different views. I think this is exactly what we need. We need a pensions debate, and we need a pensions debate also which is including in particular also the young people, because we're talking here about their future and their retirement savings. So I think everybody fully agrees on this. And if I think about IORPA, so the authority for which I work, and I very much believe in what we are doing on the pension field, so we can definitely provide facts to the debate. And this is why we are doing stress tests, and this is why we are doing impact assessments, and this is why we are doing a lot of research, and also together with our occupational pension stakeholder group, for example, where we have an array of academics and beneficiaries, members represented in there as well. I think this is really also important from to see it from this angle. You may be surprised that I will not lobby here to introduce Solvency II into the IORPs II directive. I think that debate is over. Yeah, but what IORPA is standing for is to introduce transparency, and transparency into how funds and schemes are capitalized. And this is different from a Solvency II requirement. And I know that there are fears. Once you know what the capital situation or the solvency situation is, then more or less there will be requirements how to do it. I think we moved a lot from our first proposal on a holistic balance sheet into the current proposal, and we had intense debate, we had intense discussions, and also, took a lot of considerations also on board from the different stakeholders' view, that we are now at this current situation where we are, to still think about a holistic balance sheet, which is much more flexible, which can use simplified rules for well-funded schemes and funds, and IORPs in particular, and where you can also see that there can be different uses for that transparency that is provided, and the different uses that can range from a capital requirement to more or less a supervisory debate or using it as a risk management tool. And that is different. And I think this is exactly the transparency that is needed. Because otherwise, if you don't know how the situation, the solvency situation of a fund is, what can you do about it? You can't do anything about it. You need to see it. And here I really must completely agree with all the speakers beforehand. What I wanted to do today is I wanted to show you three pictures, because I think that pictures speak more than words, or say more than words. The first one was already touched upon by Brian Hayes. It's about the dependency ratio, and it's really, and just look at the light blue and the dark blue bars. Yeah, and here you can see a tremendous change. The dark blue is 2016, the light blue is 2013, and this is this dependency ratio. That means how many working people have to more or less support a pensioner. And this is what you said, we are from four working people supporting one pensioner on average currently, up to only two in 2060. And there are some member states where the situation is even more dramatic, such as Slovakia or Poland, or also Portugal. And I think this is really very dramatic, what we see here. On the next slide, and this is, how can our children still have a pension? If they will be occupied in paying for the pensioners, that will be in a pensioner status when they are still young. Then the other slide is about the risk. So what we see is a shift, and you only need to look at the colors. We see a shift that our children are taking and have to take more and more risks. And you have two indicators for this. One indicator is the shift from defined benefit to defined contribution systems, because automatically in a defined contribution system, you pass on, maybe even to a limited extent, but you pass on the investment risk to the members and the beneficiaries in the end. And this is where we see a big, big, big shift. And the other thing is how much of the GDP the pensions assets are. And that shows you how, should I say, how strong the Pillar 1 is still in your country, or where you already have a switch into the second and the third pillar, yeah, which is the occupational pensions and the personal pensions pillar. And here you also see some countries that still heavily rely only on the first pillar. And people here may also wake up a bit then from a nightmare over time. So it's really dramatic. And it was said here, I think we are all convinced we need all these three pillars. We have a very fragmented landscape in Europe. There are some countries who have still strong pillar one. Pensions. Others are more in the occupational pensions pillar. Others still have to develop. But I think the message is very clear also from a legislative approach. We need to focus on all the three pillars. And the last slide may seem to be a bit of a complicated slide, but it's quite easy. So you have a zero line, and you look at the columns above zero and below zero. Below zero, the height of the column shows the liabilities. And above zero, as pluses, shows the assets. And you can move this part of the column, and you can put it down to the assets. And if you don't have a complete coverage, yeah, and if liabilities still stick out, yeah, if you bring it down, then you can see that there is a gap. There is a gap from liabilities that are not covered by assets. So this is the first thing that I really wanted to show you. The other thing is that what you can see here is that it's still very, very fragmented how more or less the financial situation of pension funds are shown, demonstrated, calculated, and valued, how the assets and the liabilities are valued. But you can see, even if it's done differently, you can still see, for example, Sweden has a different system than the UK. But if you then do what I recommended you to do, then you can still see, okay, good, there is not such big of a gap. But if you look, for example, to Ireland, I'm sorry to say so, absolutely. But also to Belgium, the situation is really dramatic. And the light blue line, and this is what everybody's afraid about, it's the holistic balance sheet. And still then, it was in our first quiz that we did, the light blue line is more or less showing you, calculated on the basis of the then holistic balance sheet, which was now already much more adapted, where more or less you have a gap between your liabilities and your assets, and how big the coverage is. And when it's in the minus, you see that there is a gap, but you see for Sweden and the UK that you don't have a gap, and that more or less the assets and liabilities, the assets are there to cover the liabilities. So you don't need to be afraid of the holistic balance sheet, because I think it fits quite well if you do the exercise that I recommended to you, that you take the height of the column on the asset side and put it over the height of the size of the liability side, and then you see what's left from the asset side, and you will see that there is not such a big gap between the holistic balance sheet. So we are moving in a direction where we get a system from an IORPs view that is viable, and that helps also to make different solvency positions comparable across Europe. So I think that is the picture part. I have one last slide where I wanted to show you what...
Clarify, because it looks like the value sponsor support, could that be swapped with the value of investments?
The sponsor support.
Because the red seems like...
It's the sponsor support. It depends. There are some countries who have a big sponsor support.
Yeah, but so I know the Dutch case, and in Holland that should be very small, and the investment should be very big, and it looks like the other way around in your picture. Could that...
It depends how the sponsor support in the country itself is valued, because this is the national system, how it's represented. Okay. But you say that there may be a mistake
in
the picture.
Well, it looks like, because also in the UK, it looks like otherwise there are no physical assets available, right?
Okay, it's
so
included.
You include that in the sponsor support.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Thanks for asking. So, for us, what is important as a IORPs, so we would like for the IORPs to have a strong governance. We would like to have a sustainability of pensions, and we also would like to have full transparency. I think I talked already a lot about the full transparency. And our job is also to safeguard financial stability. So if we go back to what does strong governance mean? So strong governance means that first it is about the person and the people and the staff who is managing an IORP. So here we really would like to see a strong fit and proper rule and also a strong prudent person principle, because that is really protecting the members and the beneficiaries. And this is completely different, and it's still too weak as we currently consider it in the current proposal. So here we would prefer the Commission proposal, which will not surprise you. And it's also about risk management and risk management capabilities, and how in a risk management system. So you should know about your risks, because otherwise you can't manage them. So here we need a strong, in the IORP 2 directive, a strong risk management proposal. And currently what we have, it's left to the member states. It's on a principle base, and good solvency is not included any longer. But we will have create a lot of a fragmented picture if we don't have it more harmonized. On the sustainability, so what we do, we currently, on the first one, on the governance, we conduct peer reviews, and these peer reviews currently more or less confirm the fragmented picture that we have, and we will do something in the future also on industry training standards for pension scheme trustees. So also to see, okay, good, what are the requirements, and is the standard sufficient enough to guarantee the protection of the members and the beneficiaries. On the sustainability, yes, we will continue to work on the holistic balance sheet. So you will get something in the first quarter next year, and as said, with extensive consultation with the stakeholders. The full transparency is then also on the disclosure and on the information that the pension scheme members and beneficiaries get. And here, it would be important that you don't only get it in a kind of a pre-retirement stage, but that you also get it more or less when you enter and enroll in a scheme. Even, I would agree, we talk about occupational pensions here, you won't have a choice, but at least you should know what the conditions are and what you get at the end, so that you could add a third pillar if needed. And of course, we also would like to see projections. So what will you get out once you are retired? So I think all these three phases are really important. We do currently work where we investigate which communication tools are currently used. And I'm very happy that the pension tracking mechanism is mentioned also, because I think this is a very important thing which is already implemented in Northern European countries. And that gives you a full overview of all the three different pillars and what you can expect as a retirement income. So we are fully supportive of this. We are currently engaging also in work which is value for money. And here it's in particular, you could have guessed it, it's about costs and charges. And that work just started. We had a report on costs and charges, and we found out in this report, to our regret, that supervisors really don't have the full disclosure and overview on costs and charges for pension funds and pension scheme. And that is a bit of a sad picture. And the last point is about financial stability. So here it is, yes, it's the pension fund itself, but it's also more or less whether there could be contagion effects to the system, to the financial system in itself. And if you talk about assets, I think I don't have to prove to you that during the financial crisis, assets were heavily affected. And this is why we are doing stress tests and why we include scenarios on low interest rates. And we also include now longevity risks into the stress test. crisis. For example, we do a double hit scenario, which means, okay, we have a low interest scenario, plus we combine it also with a decrease in asset values, which would hit pension funds very heavily. So this is more or less what I wanted to bring to your attention. I think it's very important. So if we want that our children still have a pension in the future, I think we are responsible now for a development of a robust and proportionate, and this I think is very, very important, because we are aware that there are different sizes of IORPs, and we have a lot of small IORPs. So it's proportionate EU regulatory framework that supports and sustainable, trustworthy, and adequate private complementary savings, and foster also the long-term investments. I think that is important, and I can touch on the pan-European personal pension product that we are currently developing, if you wish, during the debate.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we've had four extremely interesting presentations. I'm now going to open the floor for questions and debate, but I sense that there may be some questions or remarks already here on the podium. Anybody? Yes. Okay, but hang on, just one second.
No,
I'll let you all react to each other, but very briefly, and then I'm going to take questions from the audience. Yes? Okay, as the rapporteur, you have the first go.
Thanks, Sophie. The remarks on the solvency issue were directed at me and the council, I suspect. Can I just say, firstly, for anyone who pretends that this the IORPs 2 is going to fully answer the question that Sophie has put at this debate this afternoon in terms of, you know, a pension for your kids into the future, I think we're fooling ourselves in thinking that. Something much bigger needs to be done to resolve that problem. This is a small part of it, and it shouldn't be presented as some kind of magic bullet which will resolve the difficulties. What we've got to do as legislators, in the first instance, as any legislative body, and I was a member of the Irish Parliament for 18 years, is to make sure that the existing legislation on IORPs is fit for purpose and is actually going to resolve the issues that we face now. And that's, whatever we do in the future on anything else, that is the primary responsibility of legislators in this House. Yes, I was very understanding and realistic of what the Council came to. There would not be a Council conclusion had the issue of solvency being part and parcel of that agreement. We all know that. Now, that's not to say that what we are proposing in IORPs 2 should not be of the highest quality and standard. But the truth of the matter is this, and this is where the difference does apply from one country to the next. If a regulator establishes in any of our member states that a substantial or a minor hole exists in the pension scheme, under existing provision, that regulator must put in place a resolution plan, and it differs from one country to the next in the length of years that's required. That's a primary issue for the member states to determine how that hole is going to be filled. Someone must fill that hole if there is an adequacy of capital requirement there. And that is either more pay in by those those beneficiaries who are members of the scheme, the beneficiaries of the members, or someone has to pay it. Now, it is my view that those decisions are best taken member state by member state in terms of the circumstances that prevail there. You rightly pointed out the Irish example, and I noted it was a best estimate, largely because of the appalling property crash. Is that to assume into the future that there will be no recovery in Irish house prices or Irish commercial markets? No, because actually in the past number of years, there's been about a 30% increase therein. So we've got to be clear about this. If we are putting in solvency requirements that people are looking for, and I'm open to have that debate, if politicians of any description want to put their solutions here. I mean, there's one thing decrying an existing situation, there's another thing putting forward solutions. We need practical solutions. If politicians want to put that forward in the context of our debate, and I'm up for that debate. I want that debate. I think it's the right debate. But I do think we need to be responsible, but also aware of where the lines are. Now, on this remark that you made earlier, Sophie, which I do want to come back in, I mean, it is not my intention. want to make it very clear, to give full rights to the trade union movement across the European Union as absolute trustees in this case. That is a dramatization of it, quite frankly. We have many small IORPs that we know which are governed by trustees. Yes, they're interested players. Surprise, surprise, because their members have been putting their own members' money in for quite a substantial period of time, allied with employers. We've got to be proportionate to that as well. And that's not to say that in the new guiding principles that we're recasting here, that we're making it impossible for those trustees. I don't want that to emerge. But I think on the central point, we cannot pretend to the public that simply IORPs 2 is going to dramatically change the landscape. It's not. Something much bigger, much bolder, at a pan-European level needs to be introduced. And finally, on IORPs, I have the height of respect for IOPA, but their work. But I think it's important as well to answer your question as to whether or not this is legislatively possible. It's a matter in primary legislation for members of this House to decide what they want to do. I think the question of solvency too was in the first instance an issue for insurance. And not for pensions, quite frankly. And I think there's a lot of people in this House, on all sides of this House, who hold the view that there needs to be appropriate bodies doing appropriate things, not increasing more and more regulation, more and more administration for people, which ultimately factors in additional costs for pensioners. There's a very apologies for the long intervention again.
you're the rapporteur. You're completely entitled to long interventions. That's what, why we came here. Hans, you wanted to come back?
Two remarks short. I think you started with, I don't want to plea for solvency again.
Solvency two.
But it sounds a bit like solvency to me, what you all are doing in the...
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm not saying it's good or bad. Well, I personally have my ideas, but, that's not the issue here. But again, I'm saying that by shifting the responsibility from the member state level to the IOPA level, that's what's happening here. So I don't know if that's a good or bad thing again, but I'm just, seeing it happening. The second thing is that maybe we should, and I'm thinking about that also, is not all IORPs are the same, of course. Mm. And now the IORP directive is applicable to all kinds of IORPs. Even some insurance companies can apply IORP regimes, So there are commercial IORPs and there are not so commercial IORPs, And maybe that is part of the resistance, if you will, against the prudential standard. So if you take that resistance away in that field, it might be easier, in my view, to develop a regular prudential standards at the member state or IOPA level.
Okay, thank you very much. I already see one request for the floor. The rule is like this. Those who want to intervene, raise their hands. If I give you the floor, please state your name, and if you care to do so, the organization that you represent. If you don't care to do so, don't. There's already one request for the floor, the lady over there.
Yeah. So thank you very much. My name is Stella Velli. I have studied physics and informatics, and I am EU citizen. I am no lobby and no European institution, and I have some question. For the Mr. Merton and Mr. Heiss, what is this CIDC, how it works for the normal EU citizen, what is this? I never heard about it, I'm very interesting. For Mr. Heiss, you want to create more cross-border pension relationship. The situation now for a normal citizen is, I'm German, I stay in Germany, I work in France and in Belgium, and I can do it via internet, fill the formula via internet in France and in Belgium, and I receive my pension in Germany on my bank account. So I see that's a very good, it works very good. I never heard some people who are complaining about it. What you want to do more in this cross border relationship for pension for EU citizen? I don't know of the national level, but for EU citizen, what you want to do more? So my question. A question is a very interesting question. How we secure the pension for the future generation. What I think that is very important to do is to have a minimum pension for all the European citizens, because the pensions are very different in from the country to country. And after that, to do an European fund for the emergency case, not a national fund, because you see Greek what happens, if you have an emergency case, they have no money to pay nothing. So, and I am very, very comfortable to think that you have an European funds for pension that you do for the bank. If you have a bank crash, you have an European fund for this. Why you don't have this for pension? So that is a question that I don't understand. Another thing, the last thing that I didn't hear here, and nobody speak about it, you have a very big gap between the people who are working and the people who are old people and receive the pension. So in Europe, you have more and more problem that you cannot, the people who are working, they cannot pay all the pension for the other people. Do you have a mechanism to keep this equilibrium between in this situation? Because you must think about it, you know? So there are my questions.
Thank you. I think the last one is definitely the $64,000 question. we won't answer it here today, but it's, yes, of course, it's the reason for our concern. Does anybody else want to come in this round of questions? The lady over there.
My name is Sibylle Reichert. I represent those Dutch pension funds that you described. I have a general remark, which is to subscribe actually that I think the debate on whether future generations will have pensions is not an IORP debate, but it's really a broad general debate, and I really appreciate the fact that there will be probably a high-level group or a group of people that will think about it, because the coverage of the second pillar throughout Europe is really very low. So, I mean, the Netherlands with more than 90% of the working people covered by pensions is really high. And as such, we are an example, even though in the Netherlands this is not appreciated. And then I miss a little bit in the whole debate, because it's more about sustainability and safety of pensions, but I miss the adequacy aspect. And so far, still in the Netherlands, we have the lowest poverty rate, and I think this is an example. This is also an example to follow. And I have one question to Hans van Merten. You said that the council compromise is actually blocking more cross-border, and I would like you to deliberate a little bit more on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Any other questions at this stage? No, then I'll come back to the panel. Brian, you want to answer first?
Maybe. The lady asked the question on why we need cross borders. One of the reasons, in my view, why cross border IORPs fit in very well with the internal market is because you're bringing together different schemes, making it bigger, more robust, and you're also providing for the new European workforce. If I travel from Belgium to France to Germany as one region, as you rightly say, people travel and they collect pension entitlements as they go. So I think it makes sense that at a pan-European level we have instruments in place which will encourage businesses to provide those and equally professional groups as well. I had a look at the 84 cross-border schemes, and they're interesting to look at. Mm-hmm. There are actually a lot of American multinationals, actually. And I think by doing that, they're saying to Europeans, well, if you're an American US business operating in five different member states, and you think it's in your interest to have this cross-border IORP, saves you money, economies of scale in terms of total costs, what's it actually saying to other European businesses? I think it is the way to go, quite frankly. The other groups that were principally there in the 84 were professional organizations. Across the member states. So the more cross borders we can encourage without difficulty to the member states is something that I think we need to do. And I think that is something. You asked the question about the minimum pension issue, but I think that's really a first pillar question. I mean, we haven't even spoken today really about pillar one. The truth is, even in my own country, the bigger problem we face is the cost of funding what we call in Britain and Ireland over the last 30 or 40 years, old age pension or senior age pensions. That's the primary payment to people. If you pay a social insurance scheme, you expect that if you fall in hard times, you get unemployment benefit, or equally, when you reach a certain age, that you will be entitled to a state pension. But a state pension is very small. And that's why the wider debate on a European-wide scheme is so important. Now, I understand the Commissioner looking at this question. No decision has been taken as to whether a proposal will come next year. I very much hope it will, because I think it will complement the work that we're going to do over the course of the next few months, Sophie. But as to your question, yes, we do. There has to be a minimum pension provision. But there is such a variety of difference from one member state to the next in terms of what each member state can pay out. And I think we've got to be minded by that ultimately because of the scale of the liabilities.
Thank you. Just one remark, because when we talk about cross-border, there's, of course, on the one hand, the element of labour market mobility. But the other side of the coin is, of course, cross-border provision. It's providers of financial services, retail finance in Europe. So it's two sides of the coin.
It's a key part of the investment package, yeah.
That too. So I'm going to ask Hans to respond first, and then Ilya, and then Mrs. Twymuller. Hans, you have the floor.
Thank you. Few points. Yeah, what is CIDC? That's a difficult question. In the world, we have two systems. And DC, so defined contribution, is one of them, where you don't basically guarantee anything. Huh? So a DC scheme is a scheme, pension scheme, without any solid guarantees. You could even ask, is it then necessary to develop a prudential standard, you know, because you don't make any guarantees towards the participant. That's a different story, but it's connected to it. But of course, so that's a DC scheme, but you can also individualize a DC scheme in the way that you have a personal account, as it were, so banking account, basically, that you can move across Europe, in my view, ideally. But the management, and that's the first C, so CIDC, the management is done collectively on a collective basis. So it's personalized, it's a DC scheme, but the management is still collective. So that's why we call it.
Maybe I can add that actually the first, because it's really like a mutual fund, that's what we call it in America. And the C is there more for like political reasons, because at least in the Dutch case, people for some reason like collective. And when you start to propose that we should move our defined benefit system to a defined contribution system, people get a little bit uncomfortable. So so that's why we kind of, in the political debate, we call it collective individual. It's like crazy, right? Collective individual defined contribution. But it's really a mutual fund where you have a personal account, you have a share in a bigger investment vehicle.
Okay. Thank you.
No
comments, I would say. Okay. To answer your question, I think the council approach, basically the council approach to the IORP2 directive is a step back in the way that I look at it from the perspective from the EU law, basically, that why do we have EU law? To make it easier to be cross-border. You know, otherwise, it's a difficult story. I mean, you know, also to explain why we are doing a certain thing, you know, it's, you know, the European Union is there to make cross-border active easier, in my view. And I think, and that lies especially in the requirements that the council text adopted, I didn't count them, but I think there are 6 or 7 requirements now in order to become cross-border in the first place. So I think it discourages certain types of organizations even to think about cross-border activity, and that cannot be the case, I would say. So in that respect, an enlightenment certainly would be very welcome. And your point on the mandatory participation, don't get me wrong, I think that's a good idea. But the criticism, I think, it aims in the Netherlands mostly to the fact that the mandatory participation is only to a certain pension fund, you know, and that is where the criticism is coming from, not so much as the mandatory participation as such, you know, which might be a good thing, you know, and that's why the ratio is so high. But why should I be a member of a Dutch pension fund, ABP or whatever, you know, to become a member? That's the question mark I think we have to ask ourselves all the time. And that's no longer, as it used to be, that much more for itself speaking, so to say. Especially since we're much more mobile.
Yeah.
Yeah, that wasn't really a question, I think, directed at me personally. I was triggered by the mention of the lady over there, of the word adequacy, because I think that word shows up in discussions a lot, and actually it's kind of a problematic thing, in the sense that Dutch pension funds or labor union representatives often think in terms of adequacy, like as if there's some level of an adequate pension. But when you look at it as an economist at the problem of pensions, it's really a problem of distributing your lifetime income over your life. So there's not really such a thing as an adequate level of pensions. It's just like, okay, so over our lifetimes, we produce and we get an income, whether it is as an individual or as a society as a whole, and we're just deciding how much do we consume when during our working life, how much to consume during retirement. And actually, I think the fact that in these labor unions, sometimes they really focus on is, oh, this is like an adequate level, actually causes them to be reluctant sometimes to cut this level when times are worsening, right? Because they think, oh, but this is the adequate level, so one way or the other, we have to make sure that our retired...
As a percentage of...
Whether it's a percentage or however you're defining it. But in bad times, when it turns out our lifetime incomes are lower, it means our pensions will probably be lower, because you're going to say, okay, over my life, I didn't earn that much, so maybe I should consume a little bit less during my working life and a little bit less during my retired life. And well, that was just a comment I felt like is important to realize that it's really like how do we distribute income over our lives? And and of course I could continue like, okay, we have less young people to support the old, et cetera. But that was just one thing that triggered me.
Okay, this is Tweimüller.
Thank you so much. On cross-border, so we are issuing a market development report, I think already since 4 or 5 years. And the amount of cross-border schemes were quite stable, to be very honest. Yeah, it's not passing the number 100. So we had 76 now in the latest report. In the report before, we had 84, but it's around this number. And in the very first report, we did a quite extensive research. Why is this? And you may have guessed it. So the first two big barriers that were mentioned was more or less social and labor law and taxes. And this is nothing this is member state. Here I fully agree with you. And then we did a peer review, and that peer review showed that process of authorization and registration is, even if we have the IORP-1 directive, we have a minimum harmonization, but it was completely differently interpreted throughout the member states. And I think these kind of results can then also help for legislative drafting and for establishing regulation. what we find out in these peer reviews. And also what we were quite stunned is the conditions, which kind of information is requested for an authorization process, and also then how the different supervisory authorities have to inform each other and about what. Yeah, so there is really, it's very, very fragmented, and I think this is work that can be definitely useful for legislation on the cross-border. And yes, I think you can imagine that we are not so happy to have the fully funded only at the moment of establishment, and we are particularly concerned here about regulatory arbitrage, yeah, that you then choose one member state to set up the fund, and then you don't even have a monitoring of the funding of the pension scheme. So cross-border, I think, as you said it, it's important because the workforce is becoming incredibly mobile, and it's also about the investments that they can really also move around the European Union. We have an internal market, and I think this is also what the Capital Market Union also wants to achieve. On these collective investments, that triggered a bit in my mind what we are currently trying to achieve with a pan-European personal pension product. So this is pillar three, and this is not linked to employment. And what we try here is really, we try, as we think that all three pillars are important, and that is something where we try to develop something which is standardized, which is easy and simple to the extent possible. I know the pensions are never so easy and simple, but we try. And in this pan-European pension product, we try to protect then members and beneficiaries, which we call consumer at the current state. I know some people don't like then the word consumer to apply. We applied on this because it's either policyholders, if you talk about insurance, or it's investors, if you talk about assets and banks. And here we try to put certain requirements to protect the interests of the members. Which is, for example, that the provider needs to be under a certain regulation already, be it an insurance regulation, be it an asset regulation, or be it a pensions regulation, so that would then be mutually acknowledged, what we try. The other thing is also that the product itself, if it's based on investments, that there are specific investment rules applied to it, yeah, so that not everything is allowed. We also try to come up with a kind of a default option, because we know that it's very, very difficult to make a decision what to choose, so this is why there is a default option. And we also try to have the product as simple as possible, that it can also be provided via the internet. Yeah, so this, I think, could be a bit of a response, and I fully agree. IORP2 is not solving the overall pensions problem and debate. That's clear. It's one element and one stone, and I think the one puzzle stone. I think the cross border should play an increasing role here. That's really important.
On the cross border side of it, we looked at this question very carefully. And it seemed to me, when one looks at IORP1, that if you're trying to establish a cross-border IORP as a follow-on to IORP1, the barriers are very obvious. If you have to be fully funded at all times for a cross-border IORP, you're at a total disadvantage by comparison to an IORP in a member state, where it will depend from one regulatory authority to the next, the length of time it will take you to resolve difficulties that emerge. So what I've tried to do in the report is to create the same standard throughout, where you have a new IORP, that it would be fully funded at the moment of its operation, and that should apply equally to member states, to have a general European provision that is fair and consistent, rather than creating these barriers and unfair advantages. If we really want to have an internal market that is fair for all, it seems to me that that minimum standard should apply. Now, I'm not suggesting that's going to be easy to get through. I'm sure the member states will have a view on that, but it seems to me that the big prize in IORP2, if you want to call it that, is to try to come out of this process with a level playing pitch. I know there will be huge differences and difficulties for member states in that, or the perception that it could lead to the kind of regulatory arbitrage that you mentioned.
So I really fully appreciate that you want to have this on a general European provision, but then you need to introduce kind of a common measure, so to prevent this kind of regulatory arbitrage, because if these schemes then see that in a different member state it would be then easier to be funded at this moment of the establishment compared to member state B, if you want to have this on a general European provision, then you need a common measurement.
What I've said is for new IORPs that are cross-border established are new schemes that within an existing jurisdiction as they come together, I've created the standard. I can't do it retrospectively, but I've done it for the future. So I hope that will send out a strong message.
One remark, are you not creating a sort of Solvency II standard then, of Solvency Standard, by exactly doing that? Because isn't it part of this? You know?
This is what you will need. This is what you will need.
It's creating legislation.
Whatever you call it, yeah.
Skillfully avoiding the S word, but I have to say on taboos, we have a long track record in the European Union of taboos. One was, for example, in the Eurozone about transferring sovereignty, and we know what that led to, and another one was asylum and immigration, and we are seeing the results of that. I mean, reality ultimately catches up with us. And I'm pretty sure that it will in this case too. So that's why I'm very pleased that we're having we're basically breaking all the taboos here today. That's great. I love it. There was a question from the gentleman in the back.
Thank you very much. My name is Tilman Kupfer. I work for British Telecom, and we also run a large pension scheme in the UK. I have a question about the transborder aspects, because we know that not all aspects, all barriers which are affecting transborder schemes could be addressed in the IORP directive, because many of them are tax-related. I was wondering if Mr. van Meerten or Mrs. Zweimüller could maybe elaborate both a little bit on those barriers which cannot be addressed by EU legislation. Thank you.
You're absolutely right. Some of the barriers are administrative and legislative and regulatory, and a good deal of the other barriers relate to tax. And as long as this is a real taboo now, the sovereignty remains within member states to determine their taxation policy, there is very little that can be done at a pan-European level. Notwithstanding that, however, in my work in producing IORP 2, I was very conscious of the arguments that had been made to me by larger businesses in trying to set up IORPs, and they would say to me, cross-border IORPs, and they said to me, it's just at a regulatory level, it's a mess, and it's the barriers are there. So even were we to resolve some of the outstanding barrier issues, others would apply, and you're absolutely right in saying that.
Mr. van Meerten?
Well, I'm not a tax lawyer, but I understood from some tax people and tax experts and also from IOPA report that tax isn't actually an issue, because we have the principle of mutual recognition, basically, where you accept each other's tax regimes. And if you apply that fully, there, in theory at least, there should not be a problem. At least that's what I understand of it. But even if there were a problem, I think we're now 26 or 27 even, let's say 26 out of 28 member states who apply the exempt tax regime. So also in that regard, in theory, again, there should be little problems, I would say. But maybe I'm wrong. I'm not a tax expert.
Well, I mean, I can't speak for multinationals, but if you speak to people who are living in a border area and living on one side and working on the other, ask them how they feel about this, because they feel they're living in a twilight zone, I can tell you. You hear some stories that are really mind-boggling. So basically, even if theoretically it's all right, the burden is put on the shoulders of the individual who cannot fight the system, let's be honest. So when we're talking about transferability, for example, that is definitely something that we need to resolve. Okay, I'm going to call for a last round of questions, in particular questions for Brian Hayes, who has to leave in 4 minutes. So, the gentleman in the back.
Hi, I'm Vincent Hurkens. I work for Bas Eickhout, who is the shadow rapporteur for the Greens on this file. I'm sorry that he couldn't be there, but I still have two questions which I think he would find interesting. Recently, we have seen that more and more people are asking their pension funds to invest or to change their investment portfolio and to especially divest from fossil fuels or other harmful investments. So I was wondering if panelists think that this directive is also appropriate to help those people in moving pension funds away from fossil fuel investments, and in particular to IOPA, whether this is this exposure to these kind of sectors or industries are also taken into account in their stress tests for pension funds.
Okay, any further questions to Brian Hayes? Going once, going twice. No, so I'm coming to Brian first.
I had a brief conversation with Baz about this already just before the summer, and I appreciate that. And he expressed this issue to me, and I'm looking at it very carefully. I don't see why not. I mean, it seems to me that there's two issues. Diversification of a portfolio, an investment portfolio, is a good thing. Any pension funds manager would be looking into the long term as to how changes in a whole range of fossil fuels and commodities and property would affect the total yield. So it seems to me to be sensible that we would look at that. And I gave him a commitment that we would look at that in the context of amendments that he would like to make to my report. I have an open mind, a very open mind. And I'm not just saying that to be political. I have a genuine open mind to improve this because I'd like to have IORP 2, a product that would gain the maximum support in our committee and in Parliament. I think the European Parliament's at its best, actually, when it gets broad majorities and broad consensus, and I hope we can obtain that. And then secondly, on the question of, I do fundamentally believe that there again, if I'm paying money into something, part of my annual or monthly or weekly pay, and equally an employer is making a contribution, which is the case in many DB schemes, I'd like to know where those funds are going. I think people have a right to know the broad parameters upon which pension funds are based. And it seems to me that if we're moving in the direction of greater transparency, which you know some countries have adopted in their regulatory system more than others, I have a very open mind as to how we can affect that. So as I said to Baz in May, I look forward to seeing his amendments.
I think before giving the floor to Mrs. Taimula, I think there was an interesting example of how where transparency plays a role. When last week one of the major Dutch pension funds ended its participation in a company that's producing chemicals which are being used in the United States for the death penalty, and they insisted that the company should end that that trade. The company refused, and then the pension fund said, okay, fine, then you know we end our participation. So I think transparency can play a role in Ms. Toymerer.
So I'm sorry, no, we do not consider it in our stress test, but I will really pick up this as an inspiration for upcoming stress tests, so thank you so much for mentioning it. What we very much regret is the Econ proposal on the risk assessment. Yeah? So, it was already the Council who more or less put it in the full responsibility of the Member States, so we won't have standards across Europe. For the risk assessment, it's now called from in the Council proposal as own risk assessment, and here I think this is what we really regret, that considerations on climate change, use of resources and environment were removed from the ORA, and this we really regret, and I think that would be good if it could be kept, because that would respond to this question.
Okay, thank you very much. Then before coming back to the panel for the concluding remarks, I'm looking at the audience once again. Any remaining burning issues? No? Everybody's completely enlightened. That's fantastic. Okay, then I'm going to invite the panelists. First, Brian, if you still have a few minutes for concluding.
Just to say thank you indeed to all my colleagues, and Sophie especially, and my fellow panelists. I found it very, very invigorating. We have, I think, as part of our report, submitted, I think, 267 amendments. So I'm looking forward to reading all of the amendments from colleagues when they come through. I hope we can get a good outcome because I think if we can, it will set a standard for a wider debate on pensions that we need to address in the context of this mandate. And this is a hugely important issue in how we handle it. So if we get, a broad consensus, which that's my aim, I'm not going into this in an ideological perspective, I'm going in a very practical way, how we can actually resolve this issue, notwithstanding the fact that the Council have come to their conclusions, surprised to everyone, in December of last year. I hope we can get a good outcome and as much engagement from stakeholders and especially from members of the general public across Europe is something that I very much appreciate in the course of the dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for being here. I think that proves your open spirit, and I hope that we've also provided some useful input for your report. So thank you for your time. Then I'm coming to Ilya for your closing remarks.
Maybe a final plea that we shouldn't be allergic to things like solvency too, because it actually surprises me. I didn't really know how sensitive that was here, because I think there's a general principle behind solvency too, which is just recognize the fair value of what you're promising, whether it's your policyholder, your pension beneficiary. And why would anyone want to disguise his or her liabilities to a policyholder? At the end of the day, that's the people pension funds work for, right? So why would you want to understate those? And that's just, I think, a general principle that should be applied, whether it's an insurance company, a pension fund. I don't really understand. It really feels like the fact that that's such a sensitive thing here, that to me feels like signals that the parliament has been too much influenced by the lobby that I also recognize from Holland. And that's a sad thing. And well, at least it inspires me to continue what I'm doing. So that's, I guess, the good thing. And that's it. But thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't say it's sensitive. It's actually, you know, you get nothing short of whiplashes if you mention the word, the S word. That taboo has been created mainly by the Dutch and the Brits. Mr. Van Meerten.
Yeah. As I said already, I think we are in an internal market, and pensions are a very important part of it. If we look at, for example, Eastern Europe and Middle Europe, we see very low participation of the members. Some have no pension at all. So I think there lies a responsibility not only for the EU, but also, for example, for the Netherlands, which has 25 billion, I saw last time, including the third pillar, in total of assets under management. And I think there are also, for the Dutch and also for others, which have largely funded pension sectors in the Middle and Eastern European countries available. And you're not only helping yourself, but also the citizens who are active in that field or are living there, basically. And in the end, I think, so to answer the question, basically, will my children have a pension? I think yes, of course. I think we should not exaggerate that completely the pension funds are empty shells, basically. But we need to reform the system. And in my view, it's best to do that on the European level and to establish a European standard, at least, so that you comply more or less, or you have to force more or less the national legislator to take action in this field, because it's going too slowly.
Thank you very much. Mrs. Zweimerer.
Thank you so much. I would like to emphasize again how fruitful such exchanges are, to see really also the different point of views and perspective. Yeah. And of course, I'm aware that the political process is a political process. So what we can contribute as a IORP is technical facts and technical investigations to foster the debate, and in particular in these areas that I mentioned, which are on governance of IORPs, on sustainability of IORPs, transparency to members, and also with regards to financial stability and the system of the stability of the financial system in itself. So I'm very happy for the opportunity that I was invited to give our views today as well.
Thank you very much. And I'll just say that even if IORPA only provides the necessary facts, very often on the basis of facts, you may come to different conclusions than when you're in politics. I would like to thank all the panelists extensively, because I think it's been a very fruitful debate, and I would like to thank the people in the audience and those asking questions, because I it very much fulfilled my expectations. I don't think that I've had a debate as open as this and taboo-free as this in the European Parliament for many, many years. And as I said, no matter how big the taboo is, reality will catch up with us. Reality is the world is changing. There are demographic changes, the economy is changing, Europe is changing, so we'll have to adapt. And we cannot simply say, well, okay, you know, we don't need to change, we'll just keep the system as it is because it has worked so far, so why wouldn't it work in the future? I think, first of all, we have an obligation to discuss this because, as I said, we have the Stability and Growth Pact with emphasis on the S word, the stability word, and that requires of member states to ensure that their pension systems are sustainable. And there's really a question mark over that. I mean, are they as sustainable as we believe them to be? And I don't think that they are. And you're right. I mean, it's not as if, we won't have a pension in the future. It's not as dramatic as that yet. But unless we change and adapt, it may be more dramatic. Secondly, we have the internal market. So we cannot keep pretending that we have 28 different national labor markets, and that, you know, people don't move across borders, and that pension providers don't move across borders, because that too is changing. We want it to change. We want the internal market. Then we see labor market patterns changing dramatically. If I look at the Netherlands alone, I think we have about 1 million self-employed people by now who are not in a pension fund. So, you know, well, and the response of the authorities is a little bit, oh, well, they don't fit into the equation. Well, oh, tough, you know. But these people will, too, be arrive at the age of 65 or 70 or whatever, and then what? And I think there, the internal market plus the fact that, you know, there will not be such a strict separation anymore between the second and the third pillar. The two are going to overlap. And that is why we do need European rules, and why, yes, we do need to look at, let's call them, prudential standards to avoid taboo words. So then finally, they're also, you know, pension funds are also investors. So there too is a very strong cross-border component. I hope that by breaking some taboos here today that we haven't really shocked or offended anyone, but I think we have a moral obligation to future generations as well to make sure that they too will have not only a pension, but, sorry to say, Ilya, an adequate pension, in whatever way they may define it. And I think I'm also happy we had this because...
A fair pension.
Fair, yeah. Yes. A big one, preferably. But the party that I represent has actually a long tradition in taking an interest in these issues. We were the first party to push for representation of the stakeholders, i.e. the beneficiaries and the members of a pension fund, in the governance of pension funds, mm-hmm. because until then it was the social partners and those paying into it actually had no say. And we changed that. We were one of the first to call for the raising the retirement age. So, and I remember when I started out as an assistant of a member of parliament 21 years ago, she put pensions firmly on the political agenda at a time where everybody said, what are you talking about? And it's actually interesting that we're still talking about pensions. And I hope that we've just, with today's debate, pushed it a little higher up the political agenda. So I would like to thank everybody very much for coming. And I'm sure that this debate will be continued at a future forum. Thank you very much.